So if you're not speaking, please keep your mics muted to help alleviate background noise. We are using the automatic transcript if you need it. We do realize that this is not perfect, but it will be as good as it gets, and hopefully we'll be able to clean it up before the recording. I will be monitoring chat and also placing some resources in chat, so I welcome you to watch that. And please know that any resources shared and the recording of today's event will be shared with all participants after this session today, okay? And at this moment, I'm going to turn it over to Nicole.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Nikki. It's been great getting to know a little bit about the Georgia Southern context and through working with Nikki as part of SPARC's Open Education Leadership Program, of which she is both a graduate and a mentor currently. So really appreciate the invitation, and I'm excited to be here to chat with you all. So I have put together a short PowerPoint presentation that I'll kick things off with, and then I know that everybody is sort of zoomed out at this point. So want to devote the majority of our time today to discussion and you know, hearing a little bit about what you're most interested in on this topic. And I'm also joined here by my colleague Winnie, who may join that discussion as well. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen here. Hopefully this will work. Looking good? Great. All right. So to kick things off, sorry, I need to get my slides up here. There we go. So as Nikki said, I sort of started my journey in open education as a student advocate. And Open Education Week actually wasn't even a thing at that time. So the open education movement has just come a really long way over the years. And what I wanna talk to you about today is a little bit about just why open education is important, how it differs from other types of sharing materials digitally or for free, and how that intersects with equity and inclusion, specifically in the context of some of the terms that the publishing industry has started using, like inclusive access, equitable access, and how it's just not the same thing. So, you know, I think all of you are familiar with the high cost of textbooks. It's something that impacts a lot of students. It's something, you know, I was involved in as a student advocate a long time ago. And over the years, we've come a long way in raising awareness of this problem, and similarly raising awareness of open educational resources as a solution, you know, the ability to use these freely available materials that are high quality to replace expensive, you know, traditional materials. And you all in Georgia are really lucky that you have this amazing project called Affordable Learning Georgia that's supported by the University System of Georgia, and has, you know, really been one of the leading state level projects in terms of reducing textbook costs for students and, you know, supporting that work at the local level in a way that's, you know, sustainable and measurable. So when I'm talking to other states, I often point to Georgia as, you know, a great example. But there's a lot of stuff happening across the country. I mean, there's you know, a broad initiative to develop OER degrees, so developing entire degree pathways, usually 2-year degree pathways that use open educational resources in every single course in that pathway, so students can literally get a degree without having to pay for textbooks and be able to keep all of their course materials forever. And then there's also a lot of states that have adopted policies related to open education. So of course, Georgia's on the map because of the state funding, but you know, there's states like California where they invested a bunch of money in developing zero textbook cost degrees, or West Virginia has a statewide task force. Massachusetts has an initiative led by their state Department of Education that brought together all of the post-secondary institutions in the state. In Rhode Island, the state where I'm currently located, the governor issued a challenge for higher ed in the state to save students $5 million through OER in 5 years. So there's a lot going on. There's also work happening at the federal level, and that's some of the work that, you know, myself and my colleagues at SPARC are involved in. This is a group of us about 2 years ago during Open Education Week. We went up to Capitol Hill and met with some of the senators who are leading initiatives to secure federal funding to support OER for in 2018 for the first time. Congress invested some money in an OER grant program called the Open Textbook Pilot. And that's been supporting great projects across the country. So we're kind of at this point where open educational resources are having, you know, the Open Stacks project at Rice University, which many of you may know of, has reached the point where they're used at now over half of the colleges and universities across the country. And have saved students over $1 billion since they were first founded in 2012. And it's actually having a literal impact on the market. You know, I think everyone's seen this graph at some point about the rising cost of textbooks with respect to inflation. And as you can see, in the past few years, things have started to, you know, fluctuate a little bit. You know, the growth of open educational resources and other cost-saving measures have really, you know, made an impact on the publishing industry and you know, forced them to reevaluate their policies of raising prices every year more than four times the rate of inflation at certain points, which is progress. But at the same time, we're starting to see the publishing industry change, and all change isn't necessarily in a good direction. So I'm not sure, you know, sort of where all of you are at in terms of how you interact with traditional publishers, but, you know, some of the things we're seeing from the national level is things like this. The Association of American Publishers, which SPARC has, you know, gone sort of head to head with over the years on securing support for open educational resources and other policies on textbook affordability, put out this press release a few years ago talking about, we do OER too, which was, you know, just sort of an interesting thing to see the publishers jumping on the bandwagon of, you know, we do affordable materials as well. Cengage, one of the three largest publishers, put out this fact sheet with a bunch of data about how expensive textbooks are. You know, 4 in 10 students have skipped meals because of the cost of textbooks. 2 in 10 change their major. And this is literally put out by one of the companies that have caused this problem, which is beyond ironic and something we really need to question why they're doing this. You know, here's McGraw-Hill, another of the major publishers, talking about how their, quote, affordability initiatives have saved students more than $55 million in 2018, when their annual revenues are about, you know, $800 billion or something like that, or $800 million, pardon me. And the overall market is about $4 billion a year. So we're also seeing, you know, newer companies enter the space, like VitalSource. It's a distributor of e-textbooks. They're talking about how their inclusive access programs are saving students a bunch of money on campus. And, you know, all of this, you know, we're even starting to see publishers use tactics like the ones that OER advocates have sometimes done. You know, I showed a picture earlier of students holding up signs about how much they saved through OER. This is an example of, you know, a textbook publisher talking about that too, or in using that same kind of image of this poor student. So the really concerning thing about some of these trends is the use of this term, inclusive access, because it sort of taps into the positive idea of diversity, equity, and inclusion, which is, you know, values that I think, you know, every higher ed institution holds and you know, we should all hold personally. And the term inclusive access to course material sounds really, really good. But when you dive into what it actually means, it's actually not that great. And the term inclusive access is used to describe programs that automatically bill students for the cost of textbooks. So it gets automatically added to their student tuition bill or fee bill, sort of upon enrolling in the course. So it's charged as a fee. Students may or may not be aware that that's happening. They usually have some option to opt out, but that may not be clear to them. And we're starting to see this kind of program spread across the country, either through bookstores, like Barnes & Noble bookstores have a program called First Day, and through other institutional-based programs that have different names. And, these programs claim to save students money, large amounts of money, because when you switch from a expensive print textbook that has sort of an astronomical price tag of $300, $400 on it, to a short-term digital subscription that gets automatically billed to every student, you can report that you're saving students, 50% or more. The problem is, though, that those savings don't necessarily apply to all students. And it's also not necessarily saving students money, it's charging them less for them to get less. And I would like to give you an example. So let's take this economics textbook. And I did pick economics because there's actually a lot of economics behind what we're talking about. So this is one of McGraw-Hill's standard economics textbook. And I should be transparent that the screenshot is probably about a year old. So, your mileage may vary on what the current prices are. But the options that you have to purchase this on the McGraw-Hill website is to get the McGraw-Hill ebook for $54.99 for 180-day rental, or purchase the loose leaf book for $262. So if students get automatically billed for this $54.99, they're saving, 80% off of the loose leaf price. So an inclusive access program might say, we're saving students a bunch of money. But the problem is that if you go on Amazon right now, you can actually rent this book as a print copy for $23. So that's even less than what students would be billed for the e-textbook. And if a student really wanted to use a print book, and wanted to keep it, their options to buy it used and new for substantially less than the $262 that the new version is. And they could probably sell those back, unlike the loose leaf version. So the question is, inclusive access is sort of forcing students to switch to these digital e-textbooks and claiming that it's saving students money in the process, but is it really? These are, important questions that we need to ask on campus. So we're also seeing another trend, or a couple of other trends in this direction. We're seeing is Cengage's unlimited program, where students can, and again, these prices may be out of date, but are representative, where students can buy a subscription to all Cengage textbooks. And in some cases, these are actually getting automatically billed to students regardless of how many Cengage textbooks they're actually assigned. And the problem is that, it's okay if you're assigned four Cengage textbooks, that might work out okay for you, but not so much if it's only one, and it's only a subscription for 4 months. So it's not necessarily gonna save you a lot of money in the long run. So we talked a little about inclusive access, but I want to talk about what's being called quote, equitable access. So there's this model at University of California, Davis, where they've actually turned textbooks into a complete flat fee. So there are calling it equitable access and describing it as sort of like a Netflix or Spotify for textbooks, where you just sort of pay a flat fee and you get access to all of your textbooks, regardless of what classes you take and regardless of which publishers those books are published by. And, you know, putting aside the questions that I have about the fact that it's $600 a year to as a flat fee, and the average student, according to some industry data, spends less than that on textbooks, like how is that solving things? I also have a lot of concerns about the use of this word equitable, just like the word inclusive, because it's just a misnomer. You know, if you look at the way that this program works, this is literally how it works. For some students, the fee, flat fee, would be more than the actual cost of the materials if the student were to buy it themselves. And for others, it would be far less. And that's like literally the definition of equal. So all students pay an equal amount, but that doesn't mean the same thing as equitable. Just like having the cost of textbooks included in tuition and fees is not the same thing as inclusive. I think many of us have seen this image of, you know, equality versus equity. And, you know, equality is, you know, charging all students $600 for their textbooks every semester, regardless of whether that is affordable to them or regardless of whether that fits with the actual classes that they're taking, and not everybody can see over the fence. And equitable is actually distributing resources and supporting people who need support in order to get over the barriers that they face. And to connect this back to openness, I like to talk about it this way. I think this is still, you know, an evolving way of thinking about it, but I would say that, you know, inclusion is about giving people boxes. It's about the process of helping people get over the barriers that they're facing. So, you know, that's giving the people who need boxes, boxes. And open, when we talk about open in the context of open educational resources, is actually about bringing down that fence. So you kind of need fewer boxes to see over it, and more people are you know, able to stand on their own two feet and get over the barriers that they face. And when I think about equity, you know, a state where all people are, you know, able to participate fully without distinction of any kind, it really requires both of those things. It requires helping people over the barriers when they need it, and it involves creating a state where there are fewer barriers. And I would contend that equitable access, as the publishers define it, and inclusive access, as the publishers define it, do neither of those things. So, you know, I think a lot has been done in the name of affordability, and you know, the textbook publishing industry and the bookstore industry, you know, they take $4 billion a year out of the system and now are trying to keep this going under the guise of affordability to try to make these changes. But, you know, the question is, in whose service are those changes being made? And is affordability enough? And I would say no. Affordability is about addressing sort of the immediate challenges, but doesn't get at the systemic challenges. And that is why, you know, SPARC, my organization, believes that open is important. So, and when we say open, we mean something very, very specific. So it's resources that are free, freely available, free without sort of barriers of any kind, that also carry the permission to freely use these materials in the digital environment in any way, you know, that you can. And we often use the David Wiley's 5R framework for describing that. So, you know, with open educational resources, it's not just being able to use it for free, but it's also having permission to freely, you know, keep it forever, be able to reuse it however you want, be able to revise it and remix it to make it locally relevant to your students and what they need to learn, and then to be able to redistribute it whenever you want. And I think that last part has been especially important in the context of the pandemic, because you know, the traditional rules of copyright got in the way of being able to, you know, get students the resources they need when they moved off campus. So, you know, the way that we distinguish between open resources and other resources in a legal sense is Creative Commons licenses, which grant those permissions. You know, of course, the way in which a resource is shared also impacts its openness. For example, sharing a PDF is less open in some ways than sharing, say, a Google Doc or Word document that you can actually go in and edit. It's harder to edit a PDF. So there are other you know, choices that affect openness, but a lot of times we talk about copyright as one of the main pieces of that. And I think that we hear a lot about the word open. I showed you that press release earlier from the Publishing Industry Association saying that, you know, McGraw-Hill and Cengage and all of the major publishers were doing OER. And I think we need to be really careful about how we use this word open. And I always call on our friend Inigo Montoya from Princess Bride. You know, we hear that word used a lot, but it doesn't mean what you think it means sometimes. And you know, that's the same for equity and inclusion as well. And just to give you an example, the textbook publisher Cengage launched this program called Open Now, which took a bunch of the open materials that were created by projects like OpenStax and added them into their proprietary platform and added like courseware and homework software around it. So, you know, the material is still originally OER, but students actually have to pay $30 to get access to it, because it's attached to this homework software. So this would be a case where they're using that word, but it doesn't mean what we think it means. So it's easy to sort of get confused between the like open versus free versus digital. And when we come at it from a diversity, equity, and inclusion perspective, I think it's really important to you know, keep a hold of what these distinctions are. And I haven't been watching the chat, so let me just check to see if there are any problems. So thank you to Amanda for the comment about the health insurance model and the quote equitable access model is absolutely like health insurance. You know, it's in many ways, like that's the way tuition works, right? Students pay a flat fee for tuition and they get, you know, they get to make their own choices in terms of which classes they take. And, you know, higher ed has not proved effective in a national sense at keeping those costs low. So setting up textbook costs to work the same way is very problematic. So, what happened? Okay, so, all right. So open versus free versus digital, I want to run through a few examples, and I don't know how you're all feeling today, so if you refuse to participate in this, that is completely fine, but I'm going to give it a shot. I'm going to show a few examples of types of resources, and you answer in the chat whether you think it's open, free, digital, or some combination of those things. So by open, we mean freely available with the right to the permissions to be able to fully use it. By free, we mean freely available. and then digital, meaning that it is available in a digital format. So the first example is CNN, the CNN website. So digital, open, free. Which ones of those is this? So you can go there right now and read all of these articles. It is definitely free and it is digital. And I'm not seeing any open, which is correct because CNN is, if you scroll down to the bottom of the page, it's copyright, all rights reserved. Next example is the Washington Post, which is similar to CNN in that you can go to the website, definitely digital, but not free. Wikipedia. So we know it's digital. And correct, it is free and it is also open. So Wikipedia is actually the world's largest open educational resource. All of the content in Wikipedia is available under a Creative Commons Attribution Share-Alike license. So it is all three of the things, open, free, and digital. So how about this? I know in Affordable Learning Georgia, you have an amazing collection of library resources that you can access through Galileo. How would you classify that? So, you know, assuming, you know, most of them are digital, we're not going to count the printed books in this one. Yeah. So Nikki has a very good point. So it is, it may be digital and definitely not free, which is an interesting point of this. So it is probably free to some of you if you're able to log in and access the resources, but that's only because they've already been paid for and you're given access to this. So I don't have access to any of Galileo's non-open resources. I don't have a login. So all of the great things you might be able to access and your students might be able to access, you know, students in other states wouldn't be able to access. So yes, open is contextual and conditional in some cases, free. All right, so here is a digital textbook that you can buy from one of the textbook publishers. So it's digital for sure. It's not free and it's not open. But here's an example of an open textbook that is all three. So, and what's cool about this textbook in particular, digital, free, and open. What's cool about this textbook is that, you know, of course you can do all of the things that you can do with other open textbooks, download it, share it. But what you can also do is download the source files and customize it. And astronomy is interesting because what you observe in the night sky actually depends where you are on Earth. And if you wanted to use this textbook in the Southern Hemisphere, it's going to be really different. And the University of Cape Town in South Africa actually took this book and created a Southern Hemisphere version so that students are able to go outside and observe what they're learning in their textbook in their physical environment. And that's something that is only possible in the digital environment to be able to do. And I think when we, you know, sort of talk about how the, Northern, Global North dominates the information ecosystem. Open educational resources provide exciting opportunities for other parts of the world to be able to build upon these resources and make them better and share them back in turn. All right, so here's a fun one. How about print copies of OpenStax textbooks? Would you consider those free or open? So they're openly licensed, but they aren't free because they cost money to print. So to, if you want a print copy, you can, I guess, print it yourself, provided that you have a printer, ink, and paper that you pay for. And so the chemistry textbook, these textbooks cost various amounts, you know, usually $30 to $50. I have some on the bookshelf behind me, like this one. I would say that these are open resources in a non-open format. So the intellectual property is open, but the physical property isn't. And I think this is like a good example of how some things are, how open is contextual. All right, so last one, I threw this one in here. This is actually the CEO of Cengage's LinkedIn profile. I'm not sure why I picked that one, but LinkedIn is like an interesting example and an interesting question because it's not really an educational resource, but it's a service and you can use it for free, but is it free? I would say no, because what you're paying with is your data. You're giving LinkedIn super valuable information every time you log in about your behavior, what you're interested in, which, you know, they sell to advertisers and use to enhance their products. And this is something we need to start thinking about with digital textbooks too. So, you know, the textbook publishing industry is out there pushing institutions to systematically, you know, force students to pay for these digital textbook subscriptions, but it's not just about the cost of those materials. It's that students are basically also being forced to accept the terms of service and sort of whatever data collection practices the textbook publisher wants to engage in. And in today's world, especially looking toward the future, that is really important for us to be mindful of. You know, I'm not sure about what the state of law in Georgia is, but at a federal level, our student data privacy legislation was established in the 70s before anybody even conceived of what big data looked like. And it hasn't been updated. And, you know, students are left without meaningful protections from a lot of ways that their information can be exploited, especially if publishers find sort of workarounds to gathering their information outside the context of what's covered by FERPA and other federal law. So, you know, I think this LinkedIn example is an important thing to think about, you know, as we're talking about digital materials sponsored by large corporations. You know, we saw how Facebook and Twitter have become essential monopolies in their market by gaining access to all of the data of all of their users. And we don't want the same thing to happen in the education market. You know, imagine Cengage or Pearson knowing more about your students than your institution does. And being able to run that through algorithms that, you know, influence decisions that you might even make in your own classroom. So, you know, I don't mean to get alarmist, but, you know, these are real questions. And especially as we start to think about the equity implications of, you know, the biases that are built into algorithms that can be really harmful. Like we're seeing that all play out with the adoption of proctoring software. And how, you know, the use of that software can be, you know, really harmful to students who, depending on what their home circumstances are, or some of their, you know, physical diversity among humans. So, you know, these are important questions to consider as, you know, we're looking at ways to reduce the cost of textbooks. There are other ways that costs are being collected. And just to connect this back to open resources, one of the great benefits of open resources is that you have permission to put them on your own servers. Your library can archive a copy of those books, and that can be controlled by you as an instructor rather than some, you know, outside source. All right, so I wanna wrap up. Oh, that's my smoke alarm. It's just doing a test though. Okay. All right. So I'm going to wrap up by just connecting it back to this question of, like, you know, openness. Like, yes, we're all for openness. Affordability is not enough. Open is about helping to bring down, you know, the fence, and equity is about helping to lift up the box, lift people up by giving them boxes. And I love this quote that equity lives in the process. That's from Dieta Jones. And that's really what I think it sort of sums up the work that we do in education. It's about, you know, helping people gain knowledge they need to live a productive life and contribute to society, and education is an equalizer. And as we think about the systems that we use to support education and disseminate knowledge and the resources that we provide to help students learn, equity needs to be part of that. And I mean the real kind of equity, not the fake kind. So I guess the message I'll leave you with is that, you know, making open the default, like, totally get that, you know, open doesn't work in every situation, and there may not be an open resource that's perfect for your course right now. But thinking about it as, you know, choosing open before considering other options, or considering whether open is an option before moving to other options, and, you know, not settling for a quote inclusive access or quote equitable access system when we can do so much more for students by making the system open. And it's not just about open, it's about in order to achieve equity for students and broader goals. And I always like to look at institutional missions. And I love that Georgia Southern's mission includes openness and inclusion as values. And that's just, that's so important because it is what education is about. It's about bringing people in, supporting them, breaking down barriers and sending them out in the world to, you know, make it a better place. So that is all I wanted to cover. Happy Open Education Week.
Thank you, Nicole. Really appreciate that. We are going to open it up for questions, y'all. Feel free to type them in the chat or unmute your mics. Yes. And we do have one from Julie saying, is there an emphasis on accessibility in most open resources? Yes.
Yeah, so awesome question, and thank you for raising that. You know, accessibility is so important in when we're talking about digital resources. And, you know, I would say that, you know, in all digital resources, it's a challenge in a place where a lot of work is needed, both in the context of traditional resources and open resources. So, you know, like traditional closed resources from the publishers, there's a variety of levels of accessibility among open resources. So it sort of depends. But the one thing, the like really big advantage that open resources offer in terms of accessibility is that copyright doesn't get in the way. So that if, you know, you wanted to make accommodations to the resource or your disability services office, they don't need to worry about asking the publisher whether they're going to get in trouble for making changes. They can go ahead and do that because they already have permission because it's open. And likewise, that if different disability services offices across the country, like one of the things that blows my mind about a lot of the accommodations that are done for traditional resources is that the same work is being done by every disability services office and every institution where there's a student assigned that textbook. And it just creates opportunities to, you know, leverage open sharing to be able to support each other and reduce duplication of effort.
Yes, and for those of you in Georgia, just so you know, ALG has an accessibility emphasis as well, and they do check through the works to make sure that they are accessible and meet some of those ADA requirements. Leah says, it seems like if you want homework systems, simulations, lab, et cetera, you are pretty much going to have to pay something. And Leah, that is not entirely true. It really depends on the area you are in and on the library guide I have. I have several, especially chemistry labs and simulations that are completely open and free. The OER community has really been working on these. We have a engineering faculty who presented yesterday who has MATLAB software available to her students for free. And she worked on that OER product. So they're out there and they are growing. So it kind of really depends on your area.
Yeah. Yeah. And just noting that there's a fantastic simulations OER project called FET out of the University of Colorado. Actually, Pearson has incorporated a bunch of their resources into their textbooks.
That is so. On your library guide, Georgia folks, Georgia Southern folks. That is on your library guide, that one. Okay. So
I am sure it is.
Yes. Greatest resistance to OER is based on the quality of materials. Again, I would highly suggest you attend, if you can, the myth-busting session from Jeff Gallant and Tiffany that's coming up later on today, because and especially with students, research has shown over and over again that students do not have issues with OER materials and the quality of it. It is not affecting their grades in any kind of negative way. And when faculty actually take a look at some of these materials in many cases are peer reviewed in the exact same way that the proprietary materials are reviewed.
Hi, Nikki, this is Carol. So I made that comment And I am sold on affordability, so it's not at a, you know, but how do you talk to faculty who are not, right? Because one of the issues with getting it used wide scale is, you know, OER used wide scale is that the argument is that, well, they're not as good as like the traditional textbooks, you know?
Yeah, and I'm Nicole, any wisdom on how we can kind of put that myth to rest for good? Because for the most part, they truly are equal in their quality. And some of them, I would say, even go beyond the quality of the proprietary because of the work that faculty and other researchers have done to make them more inclusive and equitable, to bring in those marginalized voices, to tell the stories of groups that have not been told in the past by our proprietary text.
Yeah, so 2 points on that. So the first, in terms of how you respond to questions like that, you know, there's a very easy answer, which is go look and judge for yourself. Like, you know, professors are experts in the subject. Go see. We're not talking about a traditional textbook that you have to pay $200 in order to get access to be able to see whether it's high quality. We're talking about open resources that you can literally access right now and go see if it's high quality or not. But I think the other thing that I would, you know, challenge people to think about in the context of quality is just like, what does quality actually mean? I think a lot of times we end up using proxies for quality because that's sort of all there used to be, because you couldn't just go look at a resource. And, you know, that's things like, you know, does it have color images? Is it nicely laid out? Is it, you know, supported by you know, a fancy website, and not to discount the importance of those things. But at the end of the day, quality is actually about whether your students are going to learn what they need to learn from the resource. And I would contend that the highest quality resource in a world that students can't afford to access is irrelevant, because if they can't access it, they can't learn from it. So I think we need to approach the concept of quality a little bit differently and realize that it's contextual and it depends on your students. And in a lot of cases, you know, these big publisher textbooks are designed for a one-size-fits-all audience. So they're not going to necessarily have the best way to teach the material for your students. So there are lots of opportunities to, you know, tailor things and approach things differently. It may not look exactly the same as a traditional resource, but there are many ways in which it's higher quality if you use whether students learn what they need to learn as the measure.
Indeed, that's a perfect point. Regardless of how we feel about it, if a proprietary textbook or any course materials is at a level your students can't read it and understand it and learn from it, it's not quality. I don't care how pretty it is or how many PhDs are behind the name of the person who put it together. It's not quality for them if they cannot learn from it. Now, we've had some things come up about Wikipedia and reliability and wikis. You know, I'm just going to say as a librarian that Wikipedia has been proven over and over again that it is as reliable and factual as any of the print encyclopedias used to be. So, you know, that is another myth. And again, it's open, it's checkable. This is one of the best open pedagogy projects that people assign students all the time, is going in there, looking at these things. Can you validate what's there? Is it truthful? Can you look up where they got the information? Adding information that is missing, rewriting some of these things, making sure, again, those voices that have not been heard are being heard. There's a whole series where Wikipedia groups are getting together to write entries for, like, women scientists who have been overlooked, you know, women of color who have been overlooked in history. So Wikipedia is as reliable as any other encyclopedic resource you ever would have used. It's just teaching students what an encyclopedic resource is for and what it's not good for.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep. And would just add that, you know, most open textbooks out there don't work like Wikipedia. Some do, but you know, like for example, the OpenStax textbooks, you know, don't work that way. They have an editorial process that decides what goes into them. But you can submit errors if you find them. And they get fixed a lot faster than a traditional material.
Yes, and for my Georgia Southern folks, again, I often put out calls where some of these open resources are looking for folks to do peer review. One of the federal grants that Nicole mentioned earlier in the process, OpenRN, I put out a call multiple times to our nursing faculty that they are looking for folks to peer review that material they're creating for that open nursing stuff. Other sources do the same thing. They put out the call for experts in the field to be peer reviewers. Okay, I have some folks asking, so I'm just going to let you know. The myth-busting section starts at 1:30. That's Eastern Standard Time. It is with Jeff Gallant and Tiffany Reardon of Affordable Learning Georgia. So they will be dealing, it's called the OER Files, Open Education Myths Explained. I have put the URL, the tiny URL in the chat a couple of times. So if you're interested in that session, you may join in. And we also have one person asking, David is asking, how do you handle the relationship with the bookstore? Some bookstores are really high on all in and actively promoting as a bit of an antidote to student affordability. I feel that some faculty receive competing messages when we talk about OER.
Great, great question. And first, I just want to also plug the myth busting session. I did not know about it, but Jeff and Tiffany are amazing and you know, highly recommend that as well. So to address the bookstore question, I think it really depends. A lot of the bookstore issues vary campus to campus. So there's some campuses where the bookstore has a great relationship with faculty and the library and OER advocates, where, you know, they maybe see open educational resources as a way to keep more of the course materials on campus rather than students, you know, going off to Amazon to purchase them. You know, bookstores can order or print copies of open educational resources or course packs. So bookstores can play an important role in that. In terms of other campuses, we've heard, you know, a lot of different stories about, you know, bookstores that maybe aren't as supportive of the idea of OER or, you know, particularly invested in promoting the, quote, inclusive access programs. You know, of course, bookstores stand to make a huge amount of money from switching to inclusive access in many cases, depending on how it's set up, because the bookstore goes from having to entice students to come to the bookstore to purchase their materials to being to getting permission from the institution to automatically bill every student for access to their course materials. So there is definitely a financial incentive. And, you know, again, it depends on the campus, so I can't speak to any one context, but there are contexts where, you know, that particular motive is sort of driving some of the behavior.
All right, everyone, we are at time, so I am going to stop our recording.